coming. I hope you can all find somewhere to sit. There are a couple chairs here. Some people. I'm afraid it's our maximum capacity. Some people have to sit on the floor. But thank you so much for coming to our first educational event this term. And we prepared a couple more events for you in November and December, and you are very welcome to pick up the leaflet which describes our next events before you go. And it gives me a special pleasure to introduce our speakers to you. I'm sure you all know Ekaterina Degot. She's probably the most famous art critic and curator, specialist in contemporary Russian art. She's also the art director of the Academy of the Arts of the World in Cologne. And last year she was awarded the Igor Zabel Award for Culture and Theory for her interdisciplinary work as a critic and curator. And to be honest, when I was looking at how I can introduce Ekaterina, it's almost nothing she hasn't done. So probably I'll leave the rest for you to discover. And Olga Chernysheva, I think, is one of the leading contemporary artists in Russia. Her work has been exhibited in galleries and museums internationally, including Museum of Modern Art, Guggenheim, and she of course participated in quite a few biennales, and including Venice Biennale this year and also Moscow Biennale. So without much further ado, I would like to give word to Ekaterina and Olga. And just one more announcement that we have for you only 5 copies of the catalogue of Olga's exhibition. So after this event, if you want to rush to the reception desk, you may be lucky to get one. It's a wonderful catalogue of this exhibition. So that's all announcements for now. And please enjoy.
Thank you very much for the introduction. And thank you very much for the Grad Gallery and for Elena for inviting me. This is something I have not yet done, speaking here, and I'm very much looking forward. Thank you for all of you for coming. I know there are so many events in London tonight that it's really an honor for me to have all of you here. I'm of course very glad to speak with Olga, whose work I know for a very long time. We are also long-time friends, and we've been in conversation also many times. I hope we'll discover something new tonight, and I hope you will also have time to ask questions and to join our discussion. Olga Chernysheva is, as you know, one of the most well-known Russian artists internationally today. Speaking of Russian artists, as well as when we speak about some artists from other kind of still undiscovered territories in the global landscape, there's also the question of originality. As you know, people are expecting or looking for some originality from artists from unknown lands. Now, how this originality must look like? That's the problem. So normally, well, I wouldn't say normally, so things are, of course, improving in this field. But still, sometimes people already know how this originality must look like, especially in terms of Russian art. They know originality in Russian art normally looks like some triangles and squares and some abstract forms. And this is something people are often longing for. Where finally is originality on the scale of Kazimir Malevich? Something like that. Well, I know that you are, I'm participating in an educational program, but I know you are educated people in front of me. I know that. So you of course know that this is not where this originality hides. But still sometimes it's difficult to accept that the originality in Russian art, but I actually suspect this is not just the situation of Russian art. Working in the Academy of Arts of the World in Cologne, I'm dealing now with the very broad post-colonial, decolonizing context of global art. Well, I apologize for this term, for the lack of the better one. So I recognize many patterns, also in Russian art, as being part of that. So, as I said, you might suspect that this originality sometimes hides in realist art. In realist art, which is something actually almost all the countries all over the world share, those who had art in this sense of the word in 19th century, they went in this direction of mimetic realist paintings, drawings. So that would be something where we would at the least maybe suspect originality. And still, I insist that this way of dealing with reality and working with and through those realistic forms would represent something very original. And this is something which is really the most truly original and most truly cherished tradition in this Russian art context. So that would be one tradition Olga is working with, and we'll return to it in a moment, this 19th century, as it was called in Soviet times, democratic or progressive realism in painting and drawing. And another tradition is Soviet cinema, but also not the very first avant-garde experiments of Dzigovertov, or at least less so, as I suspect, but we'll ask Olga now. But again, something which is closer to or rooted in documentary cinema or quiet post-montage, let's say, Eisenstein films, or even 1960s and 1970s films, which do not bear this symbolism of avant-garde, yeah, so to speak. They're not something immediately recognizable as avant-garde. Also something extremely important for contemporary Russian artistic tradition, and also for self-identification. So if you would ask like normal people in the streets what in their culture, taken broadly, they would identify with, I guess they would be those two things. Paintings, which they have seen in the Tretiakov Gallery when they were kids, and Soviet film. And still, actually, there are not many artists who are addressing that. So I would like now to turn to Olga. And the last thing I would like to say, that her education, actually, as an artist in Moscow in the late Soviet times, actually combined those two things. So she was studied in the Moscow Cinematography Institute, where she was about to become an animator, multiplicator in Russian. I still don't really know how this profession animator should be called, animator. But there are many other animators, so there are confusions about different type of animators. So animator in the sense of artist. Artists who are, cartoonist is also like Charlie Hebdo is also cartoonist. So there are something, this is actually also telling that this profession, which was very important for Soviet times, and there were many extremely important and well-known and actually great artists also coming from artistic field, which were in this profession, and still this profession is not really immediately recognizable in English language. So she studied there in the Cinematography Institute, where also all the most important filmmakers of Soviet Union actually studied, I suppose, Tarkovsky, yeah? I guess.
Yeah.
So everybody, because there was nothing else. So that's everybody was studying there from filmmakers. So it was really a very prestigious and which expressed this media orientation of Soviet art, which was highly, highly centered on media. At the same time, what Olga studied as an artist in this same institute was actually realistic drawing from clusters, even I guess, or from nature, very much in the sense of 19th century realism, something which I suspect is not taking place that often, or maybe ever, in the world we are living now. So she combined, becoming an artist, she already combined those two traditions. So That was my introduction. And before we turn to Olga, I also would like us as a as an appetizer, so to speak, to this speech, to watch one of her wonderful films. In this exhibition, I also appreciate very much that you have a chance to see different media of Olga's work. This is why I think this is really a very important show, as you see mostly drawings, but still photos and also a couple of videos, which give you a broader image of her work. But still, I think that would be a proper introduction, which reflects Olga's interest in realist art and in the film at the same time. So this is like an illustration to what I just said. This is a short 7 minutes film, Russian Museum, which was done when?
Good question.
Uh-huh. Okay. Maybe kind of mid 2000s, 2006, 2007, something like that. So let's watch.
Thank you.
Olga, first question. So, how do you relate to this tradition of artist painting and drawings? Why is this important for you? And how do you position yourself?
I think very naturally, because all these images were in a time when I was in academy. We start much earlier, and all these paintings you can see from the chocolate till the.
On the cover of the chocolate box.
Yes, mm-hmm. And also you can see them in a historical book at school. So they were used as a picture of, like, they were used as a description of social life. All this realistic painting, and they really already came to the blood, and they become so alive and so also become everyday material. So they came from art world to the normal life, I mean usual life and life of everybody. So this is why I allowed myself to make a first film, which was a Tretikovka, and then those images, they start to move in this film. And I just prefer to show the Russian Museum because I like it more. It was like a second film after I filmed, I made the Tretikovka, and I really want to see what's the difference between a Tretikov gallery and Russian Museum in
St. So the Tretikov gallery, the Tretikov gallery film, so you are using the technique where this very well known paintings, they start to vibrate.
They start to move just by simple animation.
Like to breathe and to vibrate.
You can't hear it.
It was the first source for realistic things, and second, I appreciate very much this group of people who decided turn back to academical routine, and they decided to go to see what's going on with the population.
Reject academical routine?
Yes.
The movement, 19th century movement of artists who rejected academic topics in the art academy and turned into representation of real life, and actually created the moving exhibitions, were moving from one town to another, means reaching wider and less educated audiences with they are. So this, when, because I also, that has to be stressed, because when we say 19th century painting, we might have in mind some, you know, pompier, bombastic academic painting. This is of course not what we mean, and there was a very strong democratic movement that was painting in Russian art, and this is something Bulgaria
relates.
Yeah,
there's a social life.
Yes.
Yes. What I would like to say about it, that they are very good, this artist, but I wouldn't say maybe that this is my really favorite division in art, but there are some
artistically
yes, but still, I mean, I appreciate them a lot, and there are some figures who because what I can maybe put as a question for them become very important what they show.
Mm-hmm.
And not how they show things, and it were few artists who were much more concentrate on how they show things, and they were on the margin of academy, like one Pavel Fedotov and few more, and maybe I turn back to my academical education because to be at the animation department, it was something like something special, because you have, I mean, if you imagine the suit, it would be two sleeves, and one sleeve would be this art, because we were studying realistic art, we were drawing and painting for 5 days in a week, so it was like craft and this type of education, and second part was this films which we were watching. But in animation, and the animation department would be just the heart of this composition, because we always put under the question how it's done, and because animator is someone who really searching for crumbles everywhere, so it's realistic art or Soviet film or early Soviet film or late Soviet film, you always study how poetical image is growing and how it's done, how it's realized, and so this was most important for my study. For example, there is one artist I appreciate a lot is Pavel Fedotov, and for him was very important how things are and how they represent themselves. He always would find a sign to make a hint to the viewer, and he was a very good storyteller for the viewer, and this experience, I would say, is a very basic. Like not only, because what was great about this Peripheral group, they start to see in a, let's say, country worker, I know some like Vasily would play the Apollo, stay naked and play Apollo character, and academic painters, they would just paint it as a subject. But the Peredvizhniks, they would say we are interested just in this man and how he lives, and Fedotov would, if he imagined this composition, he would find the hint how it looks like, and how this person would feel in this mm-hmm. pose, and this is probably very what's very interesting.
So would you say that you are also tend to be interested more in what than in how, or not?
No, I'm more interested in how it's made, how it's done, and what are the tools, and what I like about realism, that tools are limited. And this also, like, it's not much about this expression of the artist. It's
self-expression.
Like self-expression. Mm-hmm. Yes, it's like to be quite precise and modest. And I always like some limitation in the process.
I mean, the position of the artist, who is, it's not the art for him. It's not about self-representation.
It's not about self-expression.
But it has a more humble attitude.
At least
towards life.
Yeah.
And how do you see Soviet cinema in this context? Is it for you also a continuation somehow, this tradition, or is something totally different to which you relate to it? Can you give us some names of these filmmakers?
So the list is such great that we just by dropping names, but just listing them, it will take all our time. And of course, to be a student of Cinema Academy, we were watching films which were rare, and you couldn't get them on the television. Like Ziegfeld was not that.
Well, not that, of course. That was
famous,
only mostly for students of Film Academy.
Yeah, Medvedkin, even Davzhenko, even Eisenstein. I mean, you don't see them often. I mean,
yeah, they were not broadly shown.
Even I remember we've been together in the Museum of Cinema and we were watching Eisenstein, Potemkin. Collection of films and all these treasures, they were there and we were watching them. But after, again, we were analyzing how creator would make an image, it can be ideological as well, how like Eisenstein, who was working very strongly without without doubts, you know, like to make, because he was working. I just compare unmodestly. Like when I'm working mostly with my conscience. But Eisenstein was always thinking about the viewer conscience and how film would affect the viewers. But of course,
because you're not a street artist, so he was thinking of reaching, you know, thousands and hundreds of thousands of audience.
As we discussed with you, he's not my favorite filmmaker, but also very interesting, and he's the one who made a few great volumes about how he made the film. But as we know,
his theory is actually very stimulating.
Sometimes even
more than his films. Like he was a great writer, and he's like the text about Disney, for instance, which were recently kind of revived in this animism exhibition, in the context of animism exhibition in Berlin, and in this animist discourse, which has lots of things to do with Olga's work. And I know that you were also interested in some other writings.
Yeah, but it's very, very inspiring writings. But what I learned after reading him, that some moments and some his conclusion about when he's teaching to art, because it's all supposed to be study material for young filmmakers, they also made after a film already done or after something happened. I like this example about Броненосец. Battleship Потемкин. When they were filming in Odessa, it was a few very, very foggy days, and now nobody can work. Only Edouard Tissé, he took a camera and he was moving and filming fog. And Eisenstein was already angry because films were spent. And was like nobody planned to make a fog, and this to make a picture of the fog, and this become very emotional part of the film when main character Vakulinchuk is dying. So this fog become, and after Eisenstein put it as a, this would be logical part, and how like it would be just invented before. So it's not like a lot of mistakes. They are very, very fruitful. This is also what. And as a cartoon, as a animator, you really study and how to appreciate the mistakes and some overlapping and some shortcut of the reality.
So now, when we talked a bit about this realistic painting, drawings, and film, and these are media you working with. So how do you know? Do you know when you start doing something? Will it be a drawing, or will it be another photograph or a video? How do you distinguish those fields for yourself, or you don't? Because we know that some of the works they are landing in several categories.
No, when I draw, I hope it will be the drawing.
Never know.
Never know. Yeah. Yeah, I was thinking actually today when I look at the drawings, I was thinking if I let them move as I did with Tretikov Gallery, mm-hmm. what kind of film I can get from these images, because this exhibition actually it's a first try ever when I put together photographs, drawings, video and painting. There is one painting, small painting in this little room, and this is a challenge and try for me, and I'm still on the way. Because what I'm trying to do to dissolve these strong borders between the medias, and this is how it used to be divided. Mm-hmm. And for me, it's not, again, I think as an animator, it's not so important where this image came, because if it's working, then you can analyze how it works. But first, you just got some impulse, or you got you understand, you feel like you got something, and it can be sometimes it just show how it should be. And I appreciate very much expression of Mary Toppengame, who said that ideas came dressed up, so it means mm-hmm. they came in the material. It's not like you have the idea. About how to express violence, so you just got something, or loneliness, or whatever. Mm-hmm. So you just already you see it in home, in all together in all components, or mm-hmm. partly, mm-hmm. or even like you maybe just can find a switcher, but you sometimes don't know what you found. And it start just to fall down. Mm-hmm.
It relates to something else I wanted to ask, which has something to do with all the medias, if we find the common denominator. And actually, I remember once we were talking about what is an artist in principle, and you said that still their smallest common denominator will be that the artist is creating form out of reality, so giving form to reality in different media. But still, I know that this form giving, you see it in a specific way, not as your very deliberate, very individual gesture, but more as observation of something which already takes place. Maybe it somehow relates to what you just said, and this is something which I see in all your drawings, videos, and photographs. So how are you giving form to the reality?
Yeah, I hope I'm not giving form. My best achievement would be if I could say I'm discovering form. Mm-hmm. And also, form also can be found not as a described form. It can be just a melody. It can be a sound, and it can be the some like impulse. What I'm working on. It's like to find the right condition to be open to the forms, because when usually I react on the forms, and
but you're finding them. Many people are passing by and they are not seeing them. So some of your even very early works were about finding those sculptural elements in reality, like those plants covered with cloth for winter. Or other things. So this is all about seeing those forms.
Right. But for me, it's not a question to see or not to see them. It's mm-hmm. it's more. Am I powerful enough to react on them? Because I see a lot of them, and they usually ask him to do something. And sometimes I'm waiting when the impulse growing. Or sometimes I'm waiting that like with on duty series when the people in the metro I start to be afraid that they will be gone, because mm-hmm. they already got this image, they got this not image, they got the technique.
Which work is it?
On duty, it's people who are sitting in the metro and watching escalator.
Ah, okay. And I didn't do that. Okay, so these are. Yeah, people who are, watching escalators doesn't really make things clear.
They're supposed to help if something happens.
Yeah, but the thing is, with the difference of, the difference with London underground, let's say, something else, is that they're very static. They're sitting in Moscow in these glass boxes and indeed watching all the day how these escalators are moving and people there. So that's very different. So they're not really moving around. Yeah, so this again the cultural quality.
Yes, very sculptural or photographic. Like Nadar would be happy because like, he was fixing the
people. So the
people. Yes, he was fixing the head because of very very long exposure. So this would be the, and I always watch them as ideal models, and they also it was very. Specific quality of their sitting because they're mostly were
looking
up. And this connect them to Renaissance painting.
Or something spiritual.
Spiritual, these donators, they always look at the holy sign. This could be the reason that I start to work with the subject. But mainly it's like as I feel like very, or mostly, or all of images, they are like alto portrait, and because they are very close to me.
Self-portrait.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sorry. It's like self-portraits. Because if I analyze it as a method, I would say the empathy, I would say the closeness and kind of short distance.
I don't know. I wouldn't agree because actually, every artist says Madame Bovary, c'est moi. That's clear. In this sense, yes, of course, everything you see, you film, it relates to you. But I wouldn't say actually. You don't have you ever done any self-portrait? I've never seen anything in your work. Even close
because,
to that.
Because I don't need it, because this is our self-portrait, it's enough.
No, I think you're doing, I think you're filming to hide yourself rather than to expose yourself. So it's not, there is no this moment of self-representation, of your, visions. I think you're hiding behind, and actually very successfully, behind things you see. I wouldn't call it self-portrait.
It's inner feeling.
But you have this close relation. But are you related to it as yourself? I would say you are related to all of it like your closest friends or your children or your animals, maybe.
No, if I do things, I feel very close. I'm like a dog, who is looked like the owner. So
you like a dog. I think you are the owner and they are like dogs. No,
no. No, I really attach to subject. I mean, it doesn't matter who is where in the position, but I appreciate very much Michael Chekhov, the very strong Russian actor who was developing Stanislavski.
He emigrated from Russia and became famous in the West with his...
In America.
America East the West. With his system, which was the development of Stanislavski's system.
Yes, and so they were learning how to deal with a character which I have to play. You have to just put it inside of yourself, so you don't become this person, but you just carry it as you would be pregnant by this character, and you're watching, and then the character is growing. I have I have a work about this story because it's exactly the same method animators use, because even if you have to produce very bad character, you still have to play it by yourself, to find what the mimic would be, what so I mean without this you cannot construct a cartoon.
Yeah, may okay. I already make a comment?
Conclusion.
No, it's not a conclusion. So what we are talking about relates, so the dogs were mentioned not accidentally. There is a very human dimension of what we are talking about, and a more theoretical one. The very human is that Olga is very good with animals, and she really loves animals and understands them. And I guess you see the whole world as very living, like plants, animals, and people, even objects around, they also have something living for her. And before, I guess before you wanted to become a filmmaker or an artist, you wanted to be a vet, right?
Yes.
So that's something which is important on an individual level. What I would also mention that this mimetic practice she's working with, it's also it's not this mechanical copying which we sometimes imagine, thinking of 19th century art. It's that sort of mimetic practice Walter Benjamin was describing as some very sensual practice where you are becoming extremely close to your subject. So we're imagining mimetic practice as something when we are at a distance. The artist actually will know that the artist has to be at a distance, you know, to measure the size of the figure. But that is a different sort of mimesis, artistically, but also ideologically, or even politically, I would say. That this is something about closeness, about sensuality, and also is very much related to the colonial question. So that I'll dwell on it just a second, saying that mimetic practice was at the core of European art, as you know, for centuries and centuries, yeah, starting with antiquity. But then with modernism, it happened at the same time. The modernist turn and the reference to the colonial reference to primitive art. Picasso was moving towards cubism and abstraction at the same time when he was using and working with African masks. Gauguin, so those things. So that they're coming together, and at that particular moment, at the beginning of 20th century, at the moment where this art was still part of, actually started, mimesis was blamed and cursed as an outdated, reactionary, primitive practice. Also because in this primitive cultures, as they were labeled, it was very much related to magic practice of mimesis. So this is why artists and theorists who were working on it in the 30s, and Walter Benjamin and the Surrealists, they were starting to think about this sensual dimension of mimesis, incorporating this magical moment in it. So Benjamin wrote a lot on that. Actually, Eisenstein is another theorist who is working in the same circle of ideas. And I'm always looking at your works. I'm always also thinking of this famous quote by Roger Caillois, who said that the artists or artworks are becoming similar, not similar to something, he says, but not similar to something, just similar. So that similarity is an uncanny quality of mimesis, which is in the nature itself. So to speak about representation and mimesis, we shouldn't necessarily say like these drawings is representing a concrete reality which Olga first saw, maybe even photographed first, and then it became a drawing which is very similar to this reality. No, the reality itself has this quality of similarity, an uncanny mimetic quality of the thing itself, which you are somehow seeing and you know, bringing to the paper or to the film.
Yeah, the drawing itself is an act. It's an object, and also it's like starting point as well. It's not the ending point. It's a starting point.
And it relates very much to the very very complex colonial discourse in relation to Russia, Russian culture, and Russian art. The incredible complexity of self-colonization, which was at the core of Russian modernity, starting with 19th century mainly, coloniality in relation of Soviet Union, very complex and not that simple to the other regions, something which we are witnessing in all this complexity still today. So I would say that Olga's practice is without being overly, you know, explicit on the subject, it very much relates to those entangled circumstances. So speaking about that, it's of course impossible not to ask how you relate to the reality, very much simple everyday reality of Moscow. And as you know, Olga's prefers to be in Moscow, and this is the predilection of her, this life. She likes to watch, to see, and to represent. And this life actually has changed a lot, even since she started to create her drawings and paintings and photographs. In the 90s, it was mostly about selling and buying. This very poor and very stressed out, and in a way also funny world, which was all about street vendors, even in the very center of Moscow, yeah, people were selling some stuff out of poverty. And many of your works of that time, they are related to this very primitive gesture. But how do you see it now? Now Moscow is very different. Is rich, it has lots of advertisement, is very glossy, still has lots of complexity underneath. How do you feel life in Moscow? How time is being felt by you?
Yeah, we'll speak again about images and the visuality. And first of all, the one thing which didn't change yet, it's that there are two Moscow always. There's summer Moscow and winter Moscow.
I thought you will say rich and poor, but it was unexpected. Yeah, winter.
Yeah, because it's, I don't think if you speak about London, we have this crucial difference. And for example, winter Moscow always allowed you to draw somebody in town, but at the same time just on a white background. And this background, when you don't see anything, could be just a snowish wall, like a snowstorm. And summer would give you absolutely different images.
You know, there is this old anecdote about summer fool and winter fool. Yeah, there is a summer fool. He's coming and you immediately see he's a stupid person. Okay, then there is a winter fool. He's coming, he has to take his coat off, then his hat, then his shoes, then his sweater, his gloves, his scarf, and only then you will see that he's stupid, but it will take much longer time so that you finally understand that. So it's this winter situation is about things being hidden and time being perceived differently.
You really went to the point, because I like things covered, because then you always have this excuse that maybe you just discover something that there is, and I always believe that in every action there is something which is not discovered yet and cannot be totally discovered. So this how I expect things appear. So I always believe that something great can grow from it. And Moscow, like a few maybe fresh signs which can be noticed. There is like Moscow become very much about uniform, like things should look properly. And what's
what do you mean? Military?
There are no little kiosks, no diversity in kiosks. They all are uniformed. They are typical. Oh. They're
standards, you mean?
Yeah, standard,
so they're introducing standards on everything.
A lot of chain cafe and a lot of things which now they are under the standard. And also one element which I can describe as a violent joy or violent happiness, and one sign which for me is quite painful.
Can you give an example?
Yes, I'm just going to. There are the trees which are very much suffering now in Moscow ecology, but in every dark time, especially in the winter, they all are covered by electricity.
These electric bulbs, this Christmas tree decorations.
They become, and you see, like, they are torched because also the shape of the winter tree is quite expressive. You see this mm-hmm. expressive shape. And they are covered by this light, which really push them to express joy or to mm-hmm. play the role.
So yeah, they are joy. This joy is imposed.
Yes, like mm-hmm. and this is very much now in Moscow about this imposed or pretend to be like this is about joy, mm-hmm. and little things they quite. I mean, Moscow is not a town for elderly or for children. It's mainly for I could call aggressive age, but more strong health age, mm-hmm. and many people just count Moscow as a place to get money or to apply for mm-hmm. the job, and mm-hmm. so like margin things are suffering, and but still they are become like this. New cover of new tails, which are instead of asphalt in Moscow everywhere. It looks
tiles.
Sorry, tiles.
You mean something surface. With which they are covering
yes.
soil?
Yeah, instead of asphalt. Mm-hmm. So, but still, this entire old women with strange things to sell, they mm-hmm. still appear. And this is they coming back because mm-hmm. After renovation, this summer was really really strong renovation summer, really hell. But at the end, on this renovated surface, they came again.
This renovated surface is also an interesting symbol because indeed they started at some point in Moscow to cover everything with indeed tiles, I guess of those kind like for bathrooms. And they were buying them in Italy or somewhere when there is no such a thing as coal. So it turned out in many, many places in Moscow that in winter they are becoming incredibly slippery. Yes. Like you cannot even make a step on there. Yeah, for instance, on the railway station they did it. Yeah, like so you are supposed to walk with your suitcases and you suddenly somewhere you just cannot walk. So that was a very strong symbol that this glossiness was more important than actually physical practical. Possibility to move. So it became a torture for everyday life.
Yeah, this is like violent joy.
Yeah, so that is violent joy. I like this term. So in this reality, so what? Where are you turning to? So what are you seeing? To whom are you turning when you look around in Moscow? Whom are you drawing? Whom are you seeing?
Yeah, I think I see the same. I mean, my reality didn't change much because the characters are the same. It's some they become even more visible because they were more covered by the reality, but now they are more like you see the same object, but the background is more shiny. Mm-hmm. So
maybe we'll to. Make a conclusion and then to turn to the questions. So maybe we'll watch the fragment of the film.
Yes,
show.
If yeah.
And maybe make some comments about it.
Yeah, we can look because this is a film because we didn't touch this theme, but I think drawings are much closer to cinema than to video. Because cinema is something which coming more from the imagination and video is more connected to photograph. And basically...
Can you explain a little bit? That's interesting.
Because, it's like in common opinion, photograph and films, they have the same origin. But photograph uh-huh. came as a technical part and films are more connected to theater. And
what?
Theater. To theater. And I usually was working with video, always watching or and documenting, and after make editing and just shape it a bit with mm-hmm. with the music and with the montage, with the cutting, with the montage. But one work is made more as a, for me, more as a cinema, because it's like invented, the character is playing a role.
Mm-hmm.
And even he was working as a trash man, but at the time when I met, he was making already repair in the apartment. So I asked him to repeat this,
okay,
this scene. So we played. So there are.
So the guy who you will see in this film, so he is already playing himself.
Yes.
Playing himself as he used to be like several months
before. Yes. Yes. So
mm-hmm.
this.
Okay, that's interaction. I did not know that.
Mm-hmm. But this is not shot
mm-hmm.
Directly in the cinema. It's,
mm-hmm.
Thank you.
not vision, but it's like the guy who's always collecting the garbage after the films, and it's really like a big story finished. And usually people stand up and they leave before the music.
Before
is
the credits.
Over.
Before the credits. So
before the credits. Yeah. So and just he's always a plain like somebody who's collecting the garbage or even the rest of the this big life. You know, like the scenes and like. So I really feel like. Because I've seen him first time when I was in cinema and watching a film, which was there is a format that was called I Love Moscow, and all films were about Moscow, and I really feel like this is a really part of Moscow cinema, like you always see this this person and their his obligation is just this. Now tales, yeah. Tales of the films, and every part and every film brings its own atmosphere. But he's just like a collector of this.
But this, it was always incredibly strong for me how happy he seems to be. Actually, he's collecting Oscars, yeah, for all those films. Yeah. That's what makes it very moving for me. Actually.
Because he's a very happy person. Why I also was happy to ask him to do this, because he's very satisfied and you get a feeling that he knows something who brings happiness to him. And I always admire this quality of human being.
Yeah, this is also something which we rarely see in contemporary art, you know, not just happiness itself, but it's happiness in these unusual places, say happiness in all this complexity. So, I hope you have lots of questions to ask Olga about, because we could continue for hours and hours, as you might guess. There are many, many things we did not talk about, and I'm maybe leaving it to you. The use of text, for instance, because this is something which is, of course, obvious. That this is something very particular about her drawings, and it's something also recent. When she incorporates some lines, sometimes poetic, sometimes matter of fact, sometimes strange, disconnected, sometimes contextualizing, sometimes discontextualizing the drawing. And why they are there, and what does it mean? So this is something which I would like to know, but maybe there are other things you would like to know.
Thank you. Could I ask a very simple question? This is better with game. Did you ever show the Russian Museum film in the Russian Museum? Or did you get feedback from any of the people?
Actually, it was shown, but quite recently, like maybe 1 year ago, they have big exhibition. I didn't go there, I just sent them a copy. And it was an exhibition about like artists about the museum. So all works were dedicated to the museum, to museum situation.
It was very beautifully edited and technical. You mentioned Fyodorov and the hint of something going on, and all of that was very rich in that film, and I thought fascinating. So that you at the paintings looking at us somehow.
Because,
also very exciting.
They didn't have, and now it changed a bit, but that time they didn't have any reflection protected glass. So when I came to Russian Museum after Tretiakov Gallery, it was my first impression. And they are very, very different, these two films, and I think they reflect Moscow and St. Petersburg mentality, actually. This is, they're quite portraying two towns, because they're different.
Could I just add one last thing to this, and then let everyone else go again? But the gallery attendant or security man who appears in the photograph just around the corner, you talk about him acting the role of just being.
Mm-hmm.
Just being, not doing anything, he's just there all the time. As if this is some kind of special existential state. He knows he's there, he knows he's alive, but he reminded me of some of those Malevich peasants, those front view, and some of his students, the front view, just being there, not doing anything. And I thought that was particularly interesting and rather rare if I were to look at Western artists. I don't think about them, Czechnevi or something, but that sense of existing, and you related it to the verb, the missing verb, to be, which was very interesting.
Right. No, I think people thinking all the time. So it means just this is what I like to do, just do nothing but pretend I'm thinking. So this is why I expect from them also that they're in the process. And actually, we have a lot of guards in Moscow, and it's like last 10 years sign. There are a few signs. I made drawings about it, but it's not here. It would be very typical character for a new Moscow. And at the same time, these people, they came after, they left army when army was destroyed. And they quite educated, some of them. And they just got a job to get a salary. So and they feel sometimes very awkward at this position. And some feel okay. I mean, the most awkward thing that everything is... all of a sudden we realized that all things need a guards. We didn't know before that there are so many value things around us. So that's, but mainly I like also things, because like they are, because they are very enigmatic. And if they are quiet and you have time and you have you can search and you can install your relation with things if they are quite quiet. So I like quiet things, and guards, they're mostly quiet because they don't do much.
Thank
you. Olga, who will designate
people? I wonder, given your background in film school, aren't you ever, or haven't you ever been tempted to move into full feature film production, like a couple of your British colleagues, Sam Taylor Wood, now Sam Taylor Johnson and Steve McQueen, who have turned into very, very successful feature film directors. Steve McQueen even gathered, apropos Oscars, quite a bunch of those for 12 Years a Slave. So, have you ever been tempted, or are you thinking of more probably moving into that direction?
Right. Not too much, I think. Even when I have more modest proposal, like now, for example, in Chicago University, they build up exhibition connected to Soviet Revolution. So then they asked me to make film for it, and I have no idea what kind of film I can make. So it's usually I just, if I do film, it's really I'm more growing things than building them. I mean, fortunately or unfortunately, and for me it would be very difficult. And one time when I had the idea to repeat this situation, to install this situation with a trashman, I go to Foundation VEC, which is based in Moscow, and I told them that I have this idea and maybe they have a small budget because I need to, because this is be repeated at night in a cinema in Moscow, so it's. Was it needs some support to be realized, and but most of the time I really don't need anything. I just go somewhere with a camera.
You don't need a budget.
I don't need budget, and I'm afraid also to encourage people to help me because I don't know what will be as a result, and I don't want them to waste the time. You know? Like you, I don't have this.
So you're too modest. To dream about big film production, that's what you said.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah. it never come to my mind to make something big. Because also so many films are made now. I mean, we don't have time to watch them. They were just
events,
like people discuss films, people like know the characters, you know, and now very good films are just passing and we don't see them. And at least if you have something small,
well,
you
the same is true about art.
But then if you make a drawing, you can look at it by yourself.
And it takes less time actually to watch art, even time-based art. Is actually shorter. It requires shorter time than to watch a full-length Hollywood production.
Yeah, what about novels? Should we forget those completely in the novels. It takes you,
didn't you,
years to write them.
Didn't you? Yeah. I did.
So I think something that seems to keep popping up in your work is this juxtaposition between sort of a static entity, whether it be sort of the garbage collector in the movie theater or the guard in the glass box in the tube, versus this sort of surrounding movement that they watch, in this relationship between like this static person and the world moving around them. And I was wondering if you could speak a little bit to that, maybe theme or thread throughout your work in regards to whether you think this is something in terms of just being, if it's a human entity, if it's particularly for you something in Moscow or in Russia, if it's relating to sort of a historical and social context, or if it's something else, and then also how that might relate to sort of your choice of media. As you've drawn some distinctions in terms of, you know, drawings versus photographs versus film, and whether this actually is representative of a static or sort of momentum, depending.
It looks like we have to start all over again. many questions. Many questions,
yeah. Complex questions.
In one,
have a complex work.
Yes, I forgot what I was going to say. I wouldn't say it's historical, first of all, because for me, if I say about politics, for example, I would say it's more as a politic, as Spinoza would understand it, it's more about ethology. When every creature has its own ability, its own rights, and it's like, and for me, I always prefer understand big things as a like a hill would be constructed from little parts, little entities, and this this how I would like to accept the world, and for me also if. The importance of the practice I'm busy with would be just to learn how to say to the world yes, because I'm not like that naturally, and I really think it's a very important ability, and this what I'm studying, and all things they are, if they help me on this way, I would accept them and I would work with them, and so it's, and usually I don't pose the question like would it be historical, or, and also even in history you always see the connection. So I'm more about not to interrupt things and not cut them and not criticize them, and more to gather them. And this is a way I like. If I answer your question, I'm not sure. Okay.
Any more questions?
I'm very struck with, I mean, I've always been fascinated by your relationship with fur and your skill in drawing. And when Katia described your education, she left out your year in Amsterdam, which for me has always been so incredibly important in terms of the way that some of your drawings look like Rembrandt, and also your sense of colour and sensuality. And I can't really... and for me that's so important in terms of your painting and your painterly eye as well. So to what extent did that change you from your education in Moscow? Because you talked about the drawing practice you had and the film practice you had, but I always see your work through the filter of that extra layer. Was the previous experience much stronger? Is it a kind of dialectical relationship with that moment of being in a different community as well? Because you just quoted Spinoza. I always see your work backwards, as it were, from the present, through that filter, back into the Soviet reality.
Right, you know, from now I would spend my time in Rex Academy differently. And now by memory I remember, I start to understand that there were so many fascinating points which I can really deal with. But at that time I was kind of blind and I didn't see it.
Don't you think it's filtering through? I almost think it is.
No, I wouldn't. I don't see this. I love Rembrandt, and I love him so much that I wouldn't.
But you knew him before, I guess. And there's lots of Rembrandts in Moscow.
Yeah, I knew him. And Spinoza,
Spinoza came later.
Yes, because yeah, these classical classical paintings, of course, they were in education, but also like it was like some signs of classical education, they were everywhere. Like this radio music with the classic all the time, you know, like this, and films were full of reflections of Renaissance and Rembrandt. I mean, no one step, you know, especially in late Soviet films like Tarkovsky. If you watch it, it's all full of connotations and quotations of this. So you are just.
So Soviet Union was, if I understand right, Soviet Union was this very strong accent on the classical culture, and moving to the West was actually a step into this contemporary culture.
Yes.
So that was Amsterdam was about.
And Rex Academy education was not so much about education. So we didn't have classes, we didn't have lectures, very few. I mean, like visitor teachers, and also if you don't ask to the tutor to come to your studio, they will not. It's a policy, and I didn't ask much.
I think this is the time to romanticize the concept of the Rights Academy myself, which is dangerous.
There might be very different experience. I just know that for Olga it was rather time of isolation and thinking. Where you want to go?
Also, I was with quite small daughter.
It was something where you were growing your future work, rather than getting lots and lots of experience. But there are very, very different experiences with Rex Academy, with different artists. So you are, of course, right for many other cases.
My question is about this film. Unfortunately, we couldn't see it completely. But from what I've got, there's a kind of ambiguity about how you depicted this man. You know, especially you have said that you were surprised at the Ekaterina as well. You said it. Why is he so happy? But I think this is a very kind of critical point, because you have depicted him such that we are surprised, if you know, that he is happy. But if you now think about the Soviet tradition of realism, this would be quite different. Because it's like you have not kind of brought out the reasons for why he's happy, what he's thinking about, maybe he's enjoying his job, or maybe he's kind of using the time to think about something that he really likes. But if you like, in your depiction, this is hidden, it's almost suppressed, if you like. And the question is, was that intended? And yes, why? And how is it made?
No, I wanted mostly. I didn't want to show him happy. I wanted to make him a hero, because he was never the hero of these films, and he was always like leftover himself of the film. And I want to put them under the attention. And there are some the film is like a collection of these ends of different films with different music, and also I want to show how he changed by this music, being influenced by every film, It's like other people's life, and he's always as a character in the shadow of this big life. But at the same time, he become an actor himself. I really want him to be an actor, and this was the main attitude. And at the end of the film, he's already smiling into camera and to show that he was playing the actor. But and there is even the moment when I shoot this gesture when he's keeping the bag as a Renaissance gesture of keeping holy holy material, you know,
multiplicity.
But in a painting, it's quite famous holy gesture. So I try to I mean it's maybe would be right to watch all this work, you know, to discuss. It's I didn't get this feeling that he's suppressed or humiliated by this role.
But your gaze in some way suggests that he needs to be heroized and that he needs to like, be shown as someone heroic. Mm. The question of why?
As a character, because it's I usually depict these margin figures which are not so visible. And put them on the light. I mean, they're all like this. I maybe when I say hero, like as a character, as a main figure, not as a hero in the sense that he made something like.
You need to be someone in the spotlight, not being heroic in the sense of like.
Like better to say character, maybe. This perception.
Sorry, do you mind asking a question? Is it a quick question?
Simple question.
Okay, simple. One simple question.
About today's artist in Russia. When I met his yesterday in 1978 in Venice, during the Biennale Venice, he told me, you know, we Soviet citizens, we have a double bloodstream. The official one and not the official one. Is this still the case today? And the prison system you have, that artists still have to have a double bloodstream. In other words, they do certain things,
But you know, we as a human being, we all have double blood system.
Sorry?
We all have double blood system. There is a blood which circulates in the vein and blood which circulates in the vessels, arteries. So
and, that type of blood.
Yeah, I mean there is always official side and private side of all human being, and so now of course, and this is why I think also Russian viewers and. They are quite attentive for the hints and for the metaphors, and they are quite good acceptors. They have quite trained perception for art, because they are always waiting where the hint will be will appear. But now, it depends because I think if you just depict. Things they are so speakable, and they already have this very big potential to understand the truth. So you don't have to make it as a poster. So this how I would explain this.
Well, I think on this note we must finish because it's getting very late. But thank you so much for this fascinating talk, and thank you for coming tonight. And if you have any more questions, I'm sure we can.